Hello friends, this video on agriculture part 3 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. So we will quickly talk about some of the important points about some of the major crops. So we will start with rice, which is a staple food in many regions in India. In fact, you'll be surprised to know that India is the second largest producer of rice in the entire world. Oh yes, that's true. Talking about its cropping season, it's a kharif crop because it needs high temperature and high moisture, and it also needs an annual rainfall of more than 100 centimeter. So it needs high temperature, it needs high moisture, and it also needs rainfall greater than 100 centimeter, annual rainfall of greater than 100 centimeter. However, in areas of low rainfall also, right, rice can be grown with proper irrigation, right? And some of the locations where rice is grown is north, northeast and coastal areas. So if you quickly look at the map of India, you would see the coastal areas of Orissa or Andhra Pradesh or Tamil Nadu or West Bengal. So all the coastal areas. So they are some of the prime regions where rice is grown. So that's about rice. Let's move on and talk about wheat. So wheat, the roti, chapati, paratha, all of that we eat, they all come from wheat. Wheat is the second most important cereal crop. So the first being rice, obviously. And if we talk about its cropping season, it is a rabi crop. So it needs a cool growing season. So in fact, we learned that in Rabi crop, we sow them, the crops are sown in the months of October to December, right? So that time you have the winter season. So they need winter season to grow. However, after they ripen, they need bright sunshine, right? So that way it is suitable in the Rabi cropping season. If you talk about the rainfall requirements, it needs 50 to 75 centimeters of annual rainfall, and that is just enough. And where do we grow wheat? Like, mostly it is grown in the Ganga Satluj plains, the black soil of the Deccan region. So the central area basically, so this part where you have Punjab, Haryana. So you look at these states. Now, whenever you study geography, try to keep the map open so that, you know, it sets in your mind that, okay, where do we have rice? Where do we have wheat? Right? So it is mostly, so wheat is not grown in the coastal areas because it doesn't need that much of water or rainfall. It needs cool winter season. So obviously it doesn't grow in the hot areas also. And these are some of the regions on the northern side, like Punjab, Haryana, UP, Bihar, Delhi. So these are, this part basically, it has a cool winter season. So these are the regions where we grow wheat. Next, we talk about millets. Now, what are millets? So millets are coarse grains, like they are not like fine grains, they are coarse grains. But the advantage with millets is that they have very high nutritional value. So what are some of the millets like jowar, bajra, ragi? So these are the millets and they are very nutritious. So if you ever visit a doctor, they would say that, you know, during the early years of a child, they should be given a lot of millets. If you are going through a weight loss program, they ask you to take millets because they do not contain fat or cholesterol. So they are very healthy basically. Now, some of the important millets in India are jowar, bajra and ragi. So millets are normally kharif crop. Right, and again, different millets are grown in different areas because their requirements are slightly different. For example, if you talk about jowar, so jowar is grown in states like Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. So basically this region is for jowar. Whereas if you talk about bajra, bajre ki roti is very famous in Rajasthan. So if you go to Rajasthan, you get bajra. So Rajasthan, Gujarat, Haryana and UP. So this region is bajra. So this is jawar and this is bajra. So you say it's very easy to relate it through the map. And if you talk about ragi, again, ragi balls of Karnataka are extremely popular. So it is one of the traditional dish and it is very popular in Karnataka. So Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, so Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Himachal Pradesh and Jharkhand. So these are some of the areas where ragi is grown. However, ragi is more popular in Karnataka. Right, so these are some of the regions where we grow these. Now, why are they grown in different regions? Because jawar as a millet, it is a rain fed crop. That means it needs more rains, right? So it is grown in these areas where it receives sufficient rainfall. If you talk about bajra grows on sandy soils. And sandy soils are found in Rajasthan, Gujarat because they have the desert areas. So you have sandy soils. So bajra is grown in Rajasthan, Gujarat and those areas. You talk about ragi. So ragi normally grows in red soils or black soils. So in a variety of soils basically, like red soil, black soil, even sandy loamy soils. So ragi is found in again some different regions. Now, when I talk about millet, since there are many different types of millets, so their specific requirements are also different and therefore they are grown in different areas. Now you might think that, okay, when millets are so nutritious, why are they not so popular? Like how rice, wheat, maize are popular, why are millets not that popular? That is because of less demand for millets and also low productivity. Because looking at the population of India, we actually need huge production of the staple food. For example, we have huge production for rice, wheat, and therefore we are able to meet the demands of the people. But with millets, the productivity is less and also the demand is less. So that means they are not that popular. Now we talk about maize. Now, maize is one such crop which is used both as a food and a fodder. Now, what do we mean by fodder? Fodder is basically the food for livestock. So, normally, if you have domesticated animals, you need to feed them. So, maize acts as a fodder for the livestock. Cropping season, it is a kharif crop. However, it is rabi in some regions. So, again, in certain regions, it is kharif where it needs more moisture, whereas in certain other regions it could be a rabi crop. Now some of the locations where maize is grown is Karnataka, UP, Andhra Pradesh, MP, that is Madhya Pradesh, Telangana and Bihar. So these are some of the regions where maize is grown. Bhutta. And we have so many different items that we prepare out of maize later, right? In fact, using the modern techniques these days, the production of maize has also been increased a lot. So you would see the baby corn, the sweet corn, and so many other items which you eat, makai ki roti. So all of these, they come out from maize. Next, we have pulses. Now, pulses are very important because they are a great source of protein, especially for people who are vegetarian, because non-vegetarian people already have a lot of protein intake because there is a lot of protein in fish, in meat. But for vegetarian people, pulses, dal, what we call as. Now, in pulses, we have many different types of pulses. For example, we have moong dal, we have masoor dal, we have arhar dal, urad dal. So many different types of dal and so many different types of preparation. So these are all different pulses. Now, the speciality of pulses is that, like, for health-wise, they are a great source of protein. But they are also very good to the environment. Why? Because they restore the soil fertility by fixing atmospheric nitrogen. Now, that's excellent. Now, most of these pulses, they are leguminous crops. So, they have legumes. And what are legumes? You would have seen, I'm not too sure, if you have observed very closely, all these plants, they have root nodules. Like near their roots, they would have these kind of nodular structures. And this helps in fixing atmospheric nitrogen into the soil. And we all know that nitrogen is an extremely good nutrient for the growth of plants. So plants need nitrogen in like huge amount. But unfortunately, plants cannot take nitrogen from the atmosphere. They need nitrogen in the form of nitrate in the soil. And that is what the pulses do. So these pulses, they convert the atmospheric nitrogen into nitrates and fix them into the soil. Now, I'll not get into the process. In fact, I have taught about this in the biology chapter. So if you want, you can refer that one. So except Arhar Dal, all other pulses, they help in fixing atmospheric nitrogen into the soil. So that means they are very good. Nice. Cropping season, like, they are both Kharif and Rabi, because again, we have many different types of pulses. So some of them may be Kharif, some of them might be Rabi in some region again. So region to region, pulses to pulses, that would vary. But yes, weather wise, they generally need less moisture, not too much moisture is required. And location wise, they are grown in many different states. In fact, India is one of the largest producer as well as consumer of pulses. So we eat lot of dals, whether it is in the form of dal or it is in the form of some other dish that we prepare out of these pulses. So you have Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Karnataka, Maharashtra. So all of these are like major producers of pulses. So till now we have learned about these five major crops: rice, wheat, millets, maize and pulses. So all you should know is what is their speciality, why do we need them, when do we grow them, their cropping season, that is very important, and where do we grow them in India. So that is something. So here is a gist of whatever we have learned so far. Okay, now let's move ahead and talk about some crops which are not grains, because till now we had been talking about grains like wheat, rice, millets, but now we are talking about crops which are not grains. For example, sugarcane. So the interesting fact is that sugarcane, India is the second largest producer of sugarcane. The first, do you know which country is the largest producer of sugarcane? It's Brazil. And why is sugarcane important? Because we get all the sweet items that we eat. They are all sweet because of sugarcane. Because we get sugar from sugarcane, we get jaggery, that is gur, from sugarcane, we get molasses from sugarcane. So we get most of these sweet items from sugarcane. So it is important. And the cropping season of sugarcane is Kharif. So it is a Kharif crop. So it normally needs a humid climate. So the moment you need humidity, you need moisture, right? So it needs humid climate, and the rainfall requirement is 75 to 100 centimeter annually. It's a Kharif crop. And location wise, it is grown in UP, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Bihar, Punjab and Haryana. So these are some of the places where you see sugarcane. In fact, you would have seen, especially if you have ever been to these states like Punjab and Haryana, you would see those sugarcane juices being sold at, in different corners of the city, right? So these are some of the areas where we grow sugarcane. Now we talk about oil seeds. Now they are also very important. Now the moment we cook anything, we need oil. Right? Whether we are preparing a vegetable, whether we are preparing any sort of thing, a dal or a paratha, we use oil, right? And that oil could be mustard oil, it could be sunflower oil. So again, we have huge varieties of oils. So from where do we get these oils? From the oil seeds. Now you will be surprised to know that India again is the second largest producer of groundnut and third largest producer of rapeseed. So there are so many different varieties of oil seeds. For example, I'm sure you have heard of groundnut. Have you heard of lean seed? So lean seed, which is also known as flax seed, it is considered to be very nutritious for a lot of diseases. Have you heard of sunflower seeds? So if you look at these pictures, so I have put picture of lean seed and sunflower seed because they are not very common. So many a times you would not understand what are they. Now some of the oil seeds are groundnut, mustard, coconut, tilled, soya bean, lean seed, sunflower seeds. So they are all examples of oil seeds. Now why are they important? Because they are used as cooking medium. Now again, that differs from region to region. For example, if you go down Kerala, so there people mostly use coconut oil as the cooking medium. Whereas if you go up north, there people either use mustard oil as the cooking medium or the sunflower oil as the cooking medium. So you know, different regions might have different practices, but there are so many varieties of oils which can be used as cooking medium. While discussing the cropping season, groundnut is a kharif crop, whereas linseed and mustard, they are rabi. Castor and sesame, they are both rabi and kharif. Now what is sesame? Sesame is basically till. So you know till, the white colored seed, so that's till. So in fact, sesame is, now when we say that it is both rabi and kharif, what do we mean by that? So sesame seed, it is a kharif crop in the north. That means in the northern parts of India, it is a kharif crop. But in the southern part of India, it is a rabi crop. So that's what we meant. Maybe in one region, it is a rabi crop, while in the other region, it is a kharif crop. So that's the case with sesame and castor. Now, location-wise, they are grown in Rajasthan, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, and a couple of other states. So these are the oil seeds. Now, oil seeds, important, many different types of oil seeds. Again, depending upon their specific needs, different types of oil seeds are grown in different regions. Let's move ahead and talk about tea. Now, a very interesting fact about tea is that, now tea is in a way a drink to which people often get addicted. Not often, in fact, yes, people get addicted to tea. So if a person starts drinking tea every day, it becomes a habit. Then he just cannot do without it. So that generally happens. You'll be surprised to know that tea was introduced in India by the British. Now, why is it a surprising fact? Because today we see that India is the second largest producer of tea in the world. So it is very hard to believe that, okay, we are the second largest producer. So we are producing tea in such huge amount, but tea was introduced to us by the British. Yes, that's true. The largest producer of tea in the world is China. Now, talking about the cropping season, they need warm, moist climate with evenly distributed showers throughout the year. So even though it doesn't need heavy rainfall or not very heavy water requirements, but it needs at least little bit of rainfall throughout the year because they cannot survive in very dry climate for a very long time. Besides that, the tea, you know, tea as a plant is also very specific to the type of soil because they need deep fertile soils. That means the soil should be rich with humus. So it has to be fertile, humus rich soil. This is another interesting fact is that tea is a very labor intensive industry. Now, when we say labor intensive, what I mean is the moment you look at a tea plantation or a tea garden, this is how the picture is. You would see these women or men with baskets in their back and, you know, they will be plucking tea leaves. So there are a lot of things right from the beginning till the end while growing tea, which needs manual labor. And that is why we say that it is a labor intensive industry. So manually you have to, you know, pluck the leaves. Manually you need to grow everything. You need to take care of everything. So it is a labor intensive industry. So some of the locations where tea is grown is some regions of West Bengal like Darjeeling and Jalpaiguri. So these are very specific regions in West Bengal. Besides that, Assam, Kerala, Uttarakhand and Himachal Pradesh as well as. So these are some of the regions where tea is grown. Now, if you observe these regions, you would see that tea is generally grown in slightly hilly areas, right? Because the type of climate which is required by tea, like it needs like showers throughout the year, which normally happens in the hilly area. So that's why Himachal Pradesh, Assam, so there you see a lot of tea plantation. Even Darjeeling, Jalpaiguri districts of West Bengal, they are also slightly hilly areas of West Bengal. So there also you see a lot of tea plantations. So that's about tea. Now, tea and coffee are like, you know, friends. So they go together. So coffee again is, especially the Indian coffee is very famous for its good quality. However, many a times the best quality coffee is being sent to the other countries and we are not left with the best. However, Indian coffee is known for its good quality. And talking about the kind of climate it requires, it needs relatively cool climate, not very hot climate. Rainfall expectation is 150 to 200 centimeters, followed by dry season of 2 to 3 months. So that's the difference between tea and coffee. So tea plantations would require showers throughout the year. So there should be a little bit of rainfall throughout the year. But in case of coffee plantation, they need good rainfall for a certain period of time. After that, it needs dry season for 2 to 3 months. So it's like it first needs rainfall, then no rain. So that's the requirement for coffee. And that is why we see the coffee plantations in areas like Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu. So we have the coffee plantations here. In fact, I personally had been to this place called Chikmagalur in Karnataka, and I got to see some coffee plantations there. So you can actually see that these areas like Coorg or Chikmagalur in Karnataka, they actually get good rainfall during the rainy season. In fact, in Kerala also, during the rainy season, you get good rainfall. And that is what the coffee plantations need. They need good rainfall followed by a dry season. So again, in summers, you do not get rains in these regions of Kerala and Karnataka. And that is where coffee plantations are present. So yes, that was about coffee. Now we will talk about, and then we talk about the horticulture crops. Now, horticulture includes the fruits and the vegetables. Now, again, India is the second largest producer of fruits and vegetables. So, did you notice something that we are very good with agriculture? So, we have been second largest producer, third largest producer for a lot of crops. Whether it was rice or wheat or tea or even the fruits and vegetables. Now, when we talk about the cropping season, obviously they vary for different fruits and vegetables because we do not just have one, right? There are so many fruits and so many vegetables. For example, if you talk about a fruit like apple, it needs cold climate and it is therefore grown in Jammu and Kashmir, which is like a hill station with a cold climate. Again, if you talk about something like mangoes, so we get mangoes only during the summer season. You do not get them in the winter season, right? So different fruits and different vegetables will have their own climatic needs, and that is why they are grown in different seasons and different regions. So there are certain crops which are tropical crops, that is they grow in the regions near the equator. There are certain crops which are temperate, like temperate fruits and vegetables which grow in regions with moderate temperatures. So some of the examples like apples, pears, walnuts, they grow in Jammu and Kashmir. UP is known for lychee and guava. And again, lychee also is a seasonal fruit. It comes only during 1 or 2 months. Kerala, Mizoram, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu, they are known for bananas. And again, you have many different varieties of bananas. You have red bananas, you have small bananas, you have the long bananas. So many different types again. UP, West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, mangoes. And Nagpur is famous for oranges. So you go to different parts of our country, based on the climatic condition there, you will have different fruits and vegetables available there. So it is not only with fruits, but also with vegetables. For example, we have a vegetable called, there are certain vegetables which are grown throughout the year. For example, potatoes or tomatoes or onion, garlic. So these are grown throughout the year. But there are certain seasonal vegetables. For example, if you talk about parval, a lot of us call it we call it parval in Hindi. So it is generally found in the summer season. You do not get it in the winter season. Similarly, if you talk about the red carrot, the orange carrot is available throughout the year, but the red carrot is available only during the winter season. So, you know, different fruits and vegetables will have their own timings, will have their own areas where they would grow. So, a list of the crops again, other than the seeds: sugarcane, oil seeds, tea, coffee, and horticulture crops. So, again, this is just a quick gist. So, in case you want a quick recap, so you can have a look at this table, and that will definitely help. Now, let's move ahead and let's talk about some of the non-food crops. So, till now, we have been talking about only the crops which are food. But agriculture not only provides us food, it also provides us a lot of things which are not food. For example, rubber. We do not eat rubber, but there are a lot of things which are made out of rubber. It could be the slippers, it could be the balloons, it could be the boats which are made out of rubber, and they help us. Cotton. Again, garments that we wear, our clothes, the bed sheets, the curtains, they are all made up of cotton. Jute. So jute again is used to make garments. Not only that, jute bags, ropes, a lot of other things made out of jute. And all of these are plants. They are all derived from plants. In fact, rubber is an excellent raw material for industries. It is an excellent raw material for industries. And all of these, rubber, cotton, jute, or rubber, jute, cotton, silk, all of these are known as the fiber crops. So they are not food, but they are fiber. So you'll be surprised to know that India is the fourth largest producer of rubber, second largest producer of cotton in the world. So again, good. India is always in the top rankers, right? So cotton again is the main material for the cotton textile industry. So if you look at these fiber crops, they work as excellent raw materials even in industries, right? So let's talk about their cropping season. So when it comes to rubber, they need moist, humid climate with rainfall greater than 200 centimeter and temperature greater than 25 degrees Celsius. So they need good rainfall. So if you look at this, right? And cotton. So cotton is a kharif crop. So yes, cotton also needs moisture. It needs high temperature, light rainfall, and overall it needs approximately 6 to 8 months to mature. Jute is again a kharif crop. They are more specific about the soil. They need well-drained, fertile soils, and they also need high temperature for their growth. If you talk about the locations, so rubber is grown in Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Cotton, Gujarat, MP, Karnataka, AP, Tamil Nadu, Punjab, Haryana, UP. So cotton is actually grown in a lot of places. Jute is grown in West Bengal, Bihar, Assam, Orissa and Meghalaya. So these days you would have seen that cotton is more common when compared to jute, because jute is little expensive, and because of its looks, it is also known as the golden fiber. Because of the color of the jute, it is called golden fiber. So far we learnt a lot about the different types of crops, the kind of cropping season they need, and where exactly do we grow them. So now it's time.
Thank you. Please visit examfear.com for free quality education. You can learn with a simple 4-step learning process wherein you can watch video lessons, you can ask your questions, you can refer notes, and you can take a free online test. We have content for class 6 to 12 on physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology along with practical videos. So please subscribe to our channel for daily updates. Thank you.